Hi, and welcome to Tea Time Tech Talks, a new series where we talk to IT professionals around the world over the time it takes to drink a cup of tea. I'm Sarah Torney, your host. I lead customer insights for the Chrome Enterprise team. Today, we have a very special guest, one of our very own, John Solomon, head of Chrome OS at Google. John, it's great to have you on the show today.
Thank you, Sarah. It's great to be here.
The role of technology has never been more important as it is today. Thinking about roles, John, what is your role and how long have you been at Google?
Yes, I'm the vice president of the Chrome Operating System Group at Google. And I've been at Google 2 years. In fact, just past my 2-year anniversary. It's been really an exciting and amazing 2 years.
Well, happy Googleversary.
Thank you.
Many of us have been adapting to a new way of working. What technology have you needed to get yourself up and running to work from home?
Yeah, you know, in some ways, it's very simple equipment. But the choices one makes are critical here. So I have a Chromebook that obviously I use every day, and it's the core, it's the central piece of my work. Then I have obviously my Pixel phone, which is a critical adjacent piece. And sometimes I don't want to be in front of the computer. I just want to be able to go and sit on in another chair or at the kitchen counter and just take that with me. And then, you know, for a recording and so on, I found beneficial for certain things to have a better microphone. So I have a Yeti microphone and then a ring light in case lighting requires. But other than that, it's a pretty simple setup, but it just shows the amazing flexibility one has working from home. And all you need is a few pieces of equipment and you can set yourself up wherever you need to be.
That's great. I have a Pixelbook myself. What advice do you have for IT decision makers as we transition to the future of work post-pandemic?
I think this is one of the most exciting and challenging times to be an IT DM, an IT decision maker. And really, this is a time that you can either make or break your career. I fundamentally believe this is a time when IT DMs, IT leaders who are willing to be change agents are going to be rewarded for taking a leadership position. The easy thing to do is to go back to what you had before, to just move back to the sort of old world, the warm shower, and sort of go the cozy environment of before. But the progressive IT leaders out there are going to seize this opportunity to completely modernize and redo their whole stack. And this is an amazing opportunity because it delivers much better security at lower cost, which are, if you think about it, for IT, there's really only three things you need to do: innovation, cost, and security. And innovation, a lot of times, is driven by lines of business and the work that's happening. So as an IT, you're an enabler, and you need to be able to enable the innovation in the company, but do that in a way that's secure and low cost. And Chrome offers you this amazing opportunity. And before now, you had all these objections. But as we've talked about, the objections have really kind of seemed silly right now. They realize they actually aren't that important. So there's just an amazing opportunity to lead in IT. It's definitely not easy, but if you have the courage or convictions, this is the time to do it.
That's really powerful. What motivates you to do what you do?
Yeah, you know, that's I've had the opportunity, having worked for a number of years, to have clarity on that topic. Yeah, you know, what motivates me, first of all, is to work on things that matter. In other words, I like to work on things, I get excited about working on things that have real impact. And so that's very important to me, is work on things that have impact. But tied to that, I'd like to work on challenging problems. And in particular, challenging problems where people are just sort of stuck in a rut and doing things the same way they've always done them. And then, of course, the combination of doing that with very smart people who are ambitious and want to change the world. And when you bring that combination of, you know, meaningful problems in a situation where there's sort of people are stuck in their ways of doing things, and you bring a team together who wants to challenge that, that's super exciting to me. And that's actually what's made my last 2 years at Chrome OS so amazing, because all those things have come together.
That was really inspiring. Can you share with us your journey to Chrome OS and your vision for the future of computing?
You know, I've always been insatiably curious. In fact, as a young child, I drove my parents completely mad. And I literally carried this curiosity of mine into my professional life. In the early 90s, I was working at HP. HP was the market leader. In fact, they still are inkjet printers. And at the time, we were trying to figure out how to make a printer that we could effectively sell under $150. And I got to be part of a team that questioned all the assumptions and really went after why we did things the way we did, which made people feel super uncomfortable. There's a particular example I'd like to walk you through that was just illustrative of what we were dealing with. So one of the requirements for a printer for HP, an internal requirement, was that you had to be able to stand on the printer. Physically, a human had to be able to stand on it and it not break. Now, we decided this was completely unnecessary. I mean, who expects to stand on a printer? And people were super uncomfortable that we were challenging this. They said, well, that's how we design things. We're known as an engineering company. But what we were saying instead were, what do users really care about? And so we gathered a team together who looked end to end at every assumption around printer design and manufacture and questioned it. And this was not a lightweight effort. In fact, we spent $1 billion, and this is back in the 90s, this is real money at the time, to rethink a printer soup to nuts. And as a result, we were able to halve the cost and deliver a printer that was higher quality, better print quality, much quieter, and do that in a way in a much smaller form factor, which consumers absolutely loved. So the core lesson from the story is we challenged assumptions, made people feel very uncomfortable, created incredible energy around that to create a phenomenal new product, and did something that had never been done before. And over time, by applying these principles, I've been able to have many, many successes over the years. And one of the things that it brings is brings tremendous optimism to teams. When you can actually clear the decks and to go back to the drawing board and start from first principles, the kind of energy it generates, the kind of enthusiasm and creativity is phenomenal. And you really get to move mountains when you challenge core assumptions. It's not easy, but it brings out the best in teams. And so as I said, over my career, I had many opportunities to do this at HP and at Apple. But after some time, I found that more and more things were becoming more incremental in nature. And so at a personal level, I decided it was time to move on. And I went to the world of startups, where I thought I'd have an opportunity to be able to have a bigger impact. And in fact, I was enjoying that immensely and spent some time there before I got a call from Google. When I arrived at Google, Chrome operating system was a niche operating system, but I was immediately struck by the fact that this was a whole new way of looking at operating systems. The Chrome operating system was a relook at the fundamentals of what an operating system should be and questioned everything. It really tore it apart. But the fundamental thing about the Chrome operating system is it's inherently much simpler. And that is very, very beneficial. And so as I looked at that, I was like, you know, if you could actually take this operating system and really make it the standard, it would just be a much better way to run computing. So I looked at this as an opportunity to really change computing. All we needed to do was get it adopted, and it was just going to take off. The problem was, it was a niche. It wasn't being adopted at scale. And there were two kinds of reasons it wasn't being adopted. The first were the breadth of applications. There were not enough applications from the productivity area and from creative and games that could run on Chrome OS. And the second area was around form factors.
An exciting concept indeed, John. While Chrome OS was niche, we've seen huge adoption in enterprise and especially in EDU. There's also choice in the ecosystem by extending the platform to support Android apps. This provided automatic access to the Google Play Store and the ability for enterprises to build their apps from the ground up. We, of course, have stellar web support as well. How did you begin to solve for these?
So we started working on addressing these problems, working with developers all across from largest to the smallest, from Microsoft on Office, making sure that could run amazingly on the web, to game developers who are bringing out titles every few months and getting those applications to run awesomely on the web. and started making real progress there. Because developers also saw the benefit of building their new applications on the web and not having to support a legacy operating system anymore. But the other part of it was on the hardware, the physical hardware, because at the end of the day, you buy a computer. And so as we pulled this team together, we realized we really needed to influence the ecosystem. And for myself, as the leader of the Chrome operating system team, I understood how these PC companies make decisions. I had been there. I had run those groups. And so we quickly engaged with the big OEMs of the world and got them to understand and embrace that this operating system could be a way to revitalize their fortunes and give them a brighter future. And we got the big OEMs to start building really high quality hardware, hardware that any one of us that would want to have, thin and light and sexy. And this started driving greater adoption of the Chrome operating system. But then earlier this year, everything changed. COVID-19 arrived. So when COVID-19 hit and this tremendous pandemic struck us, there was incredible pressure on companies, on educational institutions, to be able to enable remote work, remote learning. As we all know, you know, all of us started working from home and students started studying at home. And this required, you know, massive deployment of products. So there was a shock to the system, if you like, a stochastic shock to things like work from home or telemedicine. These things had been there before. Working from home was not new, but 95% of everyone working from home, that was new. And so we had this huge spike. And what we saw at Chrome OS was just an extraordinary growth in demand for Chromebooks. And you might wonder why Chromebooks. Well, the reason is pretty simple. Chromebooks are really the only technology that you can deploy very easy, very simply at scale remotely. So the inherent simplicity and security of the architecture just lends itself super well to very fast deployments with a small staff and doing that for work at home. At some point, there's going to be some kind of return to normalcy. And of course, this is one of the biggest questions on everyone's minds, is what does normalcy look like? What is the future we're heading into? And this is something that I've been giving a lot of thought to, our team has, and we really have developed a very strong point of view of what the future holds. And we're very excited about that future, and I'd like to share with you some of my thoughts there. You see, we're going to enter at a world that is at a different deployment and use of technology than ever before. So it's as if these changes that were happening, that were going to take 5 years, are suddenly happening now. The future of computing that we had seen many, many years in the future has been telescoped into the current. Once the pandemic took hold earlier this year, the objections that we had always heard about from decision makers and buyers about Chrome OS, they suddenly evaporated overnight. Because decision makers, IT leaders, suddenly realized what was most important. And what they figured out was Chrome fit the bill. I mean, I have to give you some specific examples just to make this real. It typically took us at least a couple of months, often a couple of quarters, to get a Chrome deal through decision making at an enterprise. And what we saw happening during the pandemic at early stages was very large deals. I'm talking 40, 50,000 units being decided in a weekend. Because fundamentally, companies needed mission critical work to be done and they needed to be done from home. And they very quickly realized that Chrome operating system offered them the one single tool that they could get that done securely, safely, and their workers could get going. So this is what, you know, it was really a nonlinear change. And it's very typical of behavior change. Behavior change is slow until it's not. Until people sometimes need to be shocked into realizing actually what really matters. What really mattered was secure, reliable computing. And the objection handling that had previously been stacked up suddenly disappeared. And so we had this massive adoption of Chrome happen. And it really brought forward changes that we were expecting in 5 years, it brought to the current, to this summer. So this slow evolution of computing became a revolution. And working from home was something that, you know, people always wanted, but now it wasn't something you could just offer to some employees when they want it. Now it's a requirement. And so it just was fundamental then that you have a technology that can support it. And Chrome operating system becomes the vanguard of this new way of work. You know, the thing is, in this time of rapid change, it's no longer an option to be caught flat-footed. If you're an IT leader, you really need to be thinking, well, you know, if it isn't COVID, it could be something else. And every company has always had a business resiliency plan. It's part of the audit. It's kind of dusty, paragraph 29. Well, all of a sudden, this need for business resiliency, it's actually really important. It's going to be on the front page. How do I, as a business, continue operations if everybody has to work from home? And you're going to need to think about a technology like Chrome operating system that you can deploy rapidly, you can do it securely, you can easily manage a large number of products, and you can do that at low cost. And this is just a huge benefit of the Chrome operating system, and this is why the adoption just went through the roof during this time. But the question still is most interesting for many of you and many of us is, what happens post-COVID? What's the world going to be like? Now, we've seen people like Jack Dorsey at Twitter say that, you know, everyone's just going to work from home all the time. And I take a slightly different view of this. I think there's going to be a newfound agility of being able to work from home when you need to and work in the office when you need to. I feel much more optimistic about work from home, where technology-enabled work from home puts more onus and creativity with all of us and empowers us to essentially do the work we want to do. Technology at its heart is an enabler for productivity and creativity, and everything else just gets in the way. And in a modern operating system, when you can have your data in the cloud available anywhere on any device like Chrome OS, and you can work as effectively from home or in the office, that is the kind of technology that really will shape the future. The layer on top of that, the social pressure now of increased congestion, so the social benefits of not having to commute, and the issues we've got with global warming, and the benefit to society of less trips being done, less airplanes, less cars. These are all really big factors that will drive a need to have work from home be a really big part of a society going forward and allow for an agility and a fluidity in how we work. It'll be sometimes at home and sometimes in the office. And so I go back to where I started. It's not about being able to stand on a printer. It's about questioning the core assumptions of any technology and understanding in today's world, with what we have going on today, what are the core attributes that really matter? And we really believe it's security, manageability, the ability to be able to collaborate in real time and do that in a way with a device that's affordable. These are the benefits of Chrome operating system that make us incredibly optimistic about the future of computing on Chrome OS.
That really resonates. Thank you so much for sharing your story with us today, John. It's been great having you on the show.
Yeah, thank you, Sarah. And I'm glad to have had the opportunity to share my personal narrative with you. But it's one thing to hear from me. What I'm also really excited going forward is that you'll be able to hear from our customers, clients of Google, of Chrome OS, who've been able to deploy the Chrome technology that I've been talking about and do that with success. So coming soon to the next episode of our series here is the CTO of Synchrony Financial. And what they've been able to do is deploy Chrome Enterprise technology really effectively. And you're going to hear firsthand of their story, their success, and their challenges. Stay tuned.
Thanks for joining us on Tea Time Tech Talks.